origins of Carnival trace back to Europe with extravagant costume parties before the beginning of Lent, the Catholic period of fasting. When Europeans colonized the Caribbean and the Americas, they brought along the tradition, which took a new flavor once the slave trade from Africa began. Fast forward to today, and the Carnival circuit is now an international phenomenon. We invited our next two guests to discuss the history and culture of Carnival, from its origin, dazzling costume and dance, and the theme behind celebration in different countries. Joining us for this segment, Patricia Saunders, Associate Professor of English and Director of the Caribbean Literary and Cultural Studies Program at the University of Miami. And Rose Kelly Prescott, Costume Designer and Band Leader and founding member of the Carnival Band Heritage, TNT. Thank you both for joining us today.
Thank you for inviting us.
Definitely. Well, Patricia, let me start with you and tell me a little bit about the story of Carnival. Where did it originate and how was it brought to the Caribbean?
Well, I mean, as far as the date can be contested, but I think in the late, I would say 1770s, 1780s, there was a cedula of population that brought a number of Spanish-speaking people to Trinidad in particular. Mm-hmm. The French soon followed, and with them came the tradition of Carnival. So it's several hundred years old in the English-speaking Caribbean. Mm-hmm. Of course, as the slave trade began, some of these, like many other traditions in the Caribbean, it was Creolized. It was Creolized when the slaves took different aspects of the Carnival and imbued it with their own meaning, their own religious symbolism. The important thing to remember about Carnival is it's also a tool for social and political commentary. So the slaves used that as a moment as well to resist and to borrow from this tradition as a means of criticizing not only slavery, but their masters. And most importantly, what we don't think about is that the Carnival tradition also became a way of expressing freedom, mm-hmm. even in the context of slavery. Obviously, that has, and that continued to change from the 18th century right up to the 21st century.
And this is the example of Trinidad, but it happened this way in other islands, even if it was not an English-speaking island, like French island, it was the same way also,
yes.
as you use the Carnival. Rose, I know that you teach children mm-hmm. the history of Carnival. Why do you think it's important for them to know that it's just not about the costume and the partying and the walking men in the streets?
Because the kids are the future of Carnival. And if they don't know the history, then they won't be able to express themselves and know what the dancing and the revelry is all about. You know, so there was a need to teach these kids because they've come here, their parents came here and the kids are here, but the children don't know about Carnival. And the parents never taught them. So I thought it's a great idea if I could just teach these kids what Carnival is all about.
Mm-hmm. Can you explain the relation with the Catholic religion?
Yes, Carnival started from Christmas to Ash Wednesday. And it was the people dressed in with masks. They use a lot of masks from the French. Mm-hmm. And this hid themselves, yes. and then they on Ash Wednesday they would go to church and get the ashes and be resolved mm-hmm. from the sins, you know.
Yes, that's when after Ash Wednesday, that's when the Lent period starts.
Yes,
Patricia,
yes.
Right?
And we have to remember the name Carnival.
Yes,
its very origin is a farewell to the flesh.
Yes,
right. And so, in an interesting way, there is this interesting. And again, if we think about it, both as a mode of celebration and expression, but also as a way of a kind of throwing off of all of the usual modes of oppression, if only for these 2 days. There's a sense, and I think it's a deeply religious sense, of allowing the soul this moment of expression through this art form. Mm-hmm. Yes. So it's particularly, it's an interesting kind of almost a contradiction between the spiritual side of it, as well as some would say the revelry and the bacchanal, as we call it in Trinidad.
Yes, definitely. Well, you have the different island that has their mm-hmm. own tradition. Most of them follow the Catholic calendar, like we said, after Christmas until Ash Wednesday. Mm-hmm. But let's focus a little bit on Trinidad right now and the islands that have the same tradition. You have different events during the Carnival week, I want to say. You have Juve, you have Ash Wednesday, you have the Carnival Tuesday, which we call Mardi Gras in the other islands.
We have Dimanche Gras.
Yeah, exactly. So, well, let's start with you, Rose. Can you tell me a little bit about the Mardi Gras, the Carnival Tuesday, and the Ash Wednesday?
Okay. Well, I'll start from the Juve.
Juve
is the beginning of the Carnival. It starts like 5 o'clock in the morning, and the clothes that are worn are from the years before, or old clothes, you know, and they were dressed with mud and paints all over the bodies, and they come out at this time. And we have the music trucks, and they go on the streets and parade. And then when the sun comes up, like about 10 o'clock, they go back home and they dress on Monday into their nice costumes. But before the Juve, we have what is called the Dimanche Gras, from the French word again. We have all we have the calypsos, and we have the competitions of the Queen and King of Carnival on this particular night. And the calypsos is all a commentary about politics and whatever is going on in the country at that particular time. And then it goes into the Juve. Okay. And then into Carnival Monday, where Carnival Monday evening, where we go. Now we just dress, not in full costumes, you know, and we parade. We still go on the stage and have a great time. But Carnival Tuesday
is the day. Yes.
And we get out there. We start getting dressed at 5 o'clock in the morning.
And it's all because day celebration.
It's all day. Because the bands, we meet at 7. We have to be there at 7. If we're not there, the trucks go without the masqueraders. So you have to be there. And everybody's dressed in the full costumes.
And they celebrate all day on the music.
And they celebrate, yes.
Just to clarify, Juve is a French word, and it means the day's opening, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And I think it's important that how Juve came about was that during slavery, the slaves were anxious to start the carnival as soon as possible, because for them it was really an important kind of spiritual ceremony. So they sort of implemented a kind of curfew, if you will, so that it couldn't begin until first light. And it's important, part of the wearing of the old clothes and the old rags, again, keeping in mind this sort of spiritual relevance from Juve morning to Carnival Tuesday, there's a lot more mud mass and paints and different things like that. And if you follow that to Carnival Tuesday, it's almost a movement of rebirth, so that you move from the mud mass to the Monday mass, where you're in partial costume, where the revelry begins. And then on Tuesday, as we call it, you have the pretty mass.
Yes.
And it's almost as if you move from
from
the caterpillar to the butterfly sort of thing.
That's a great history. So now let's fast forward to today, 21st century. Now, a lot of people think Carnival, we have Carnival in Miami coming up in a month. Mm-hmm. So just think of the costume, the music, the liquor in the street, basically. So they don't really know the history of it. And some people don't really want to know about it. Just think about the fun part. And it's such a rich history. Let's talk about the costume first, how the costume evolved. And I know, Rose, that you've been designing costume for a long time now. So can you tell me how the costume evolved to what it was 20 years ago to now?
Yeah. Well, we first started off imitating the French masters, and the word masque came from masquerade, because the French used to have these masquerade balls, and they would dress up all fancy, and the slaves, you know, would mimic them and wear these costumes. And then we evolved into now, where we wear more skimpier costumes, you know? And it's the emancipation of the women, you know?
We're actually showing some pictures of the band Generation X right now, to show some example.
Right, so now you see the reason for the skimpier costumes. Women feel, and you see more women in the band than men, because they feel, you know, they overpower, the emancipation, the freedom, you know,
woman.
It's the freedom of the woman. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Patricia, you wanted to add something?
Well, I would also say, in addition to the beauty of mass, again, we focus on the costumes, but there's also two other important components that are integral to Carnival. Calypso music, which is an important mode of social commentary that also provides the soundtrack, if you will, for Carnival, and of course, steel band. And so one of the other things that's interesting, for example, in terms of how Carnival broke out of the Caribbean, you had Caribbean people migrating, inter-island migration. So the Carnival grew in that regard, and it was further creolized, because as you say, there's Carnival in Guadeloupe and Martinique and
right
Jamaica.
Right now, they're showing actually pictures of the Carnival Nation in Miami, right, which is a band that came from Toronto. So
exactly, and costumes. Same thing with the steel band. You have steel band in Tokyo. You have steel band on the African continent. It's really mutated. I just returned from Notting Hill Carnival in London,
Carnival, yes,
which is huge. I mean,
and when does this take place usually?
It's usually the last Monday in August.
So they don't follow the Catholic calendar.
Exactly.
For those ones.
Right.
Okay. So and
Miami doesn't. In New York City, it's Labor Day. It's on Monday. I think the Monday after.
So
Labor
you have
Day.
Notting Hill Carnival end of August. You have Labor Day in New York.
Yes.
And after in October, you have Miami.
Miami. We can't forget Caribana.
Caribana, of course, in July in Toronto.
In July, D.C., Atlanta. I mean, so in a way, the different places that the mask, that Carnival has sort of proliferated to is an indication of all of the different paths of migration of Caribbean people. And so it's interesting that in all of these places, as it's broken away from the Lenten calendar, it's also become an expression of pan-Caribbean solidarity. So many people will say that Carnival is one of the places where Caribbean Federation succeeded. Right, it may not have succeeded politically, but it has certainly succeeded culturally.
Yeah, everybody
in terms
comes together,
of, exactly,
celebrate together.
Exactly.
Well, go ahead.
To add what Patrick just said, I was invited to Gabon, Africa, to do Carnival there this year. The president, they were celebrating the 50th anniversary from the French, and they wanted to have a Carnival celebration. So we took costumes and they had a great time.
Oh, wow.
It was
well,
so
it's definitely
Carnival,
an international,
you know,
celebration.
Yes, it is.
Well, another component is the children, Carnival. A lot, yes, of time people forget that children are also in Carnival. And it's a different day. I know in Miami, usually
yes,
it's a week before.
It's October 3rd.
Okay. And you design costumes,
yes,
for some of the children.
Yes, I have a kids band. And at the kids Carnival, you really see the creativity in Carnival, mm-hmm, you know. So I'm inviting you to come down to the Betty,
yes,
Ferguson.
So how does the children react to the costume and the music? Do they understand fully what is happening?
Yes, well, I do it as a teaching for the kids. So when they come, I explain to them what the costume is about and what they're portraying so that they understand what we're doing. You know, so on that day, you know, you can see the kids really expressing themselves, you know, because when they put on the costume, you know, oh, this is me. If I'm the Batman, I'm portraying that costume, you
so
know?
So they will know the difference between dressing up for Halloween and dressing up for,
yes,
Carnival.
Yes.
And I think one of the interesting things, both with the kiddies Carnival and the costume itself, is that the costume is a way of telling a story. Every band has a theme or a narrative.
Yes.
More often than not, it can be an epic narrative, where each section is almost a different chapter,
yes,
if you will, in the telling of the story. Mm-hmm. And so I think for kids who are accustomed to sort of story time and where their imaginations are greatest, it really is an opportunity for them to sort of inhabit that imaginary world,
yes,
through the costuming and through the Carnival as well. And I think that also translates into the adult Carnival, because there's a long tradition of oral culture in the Caribbean, and that oral culture is not just verbal storytelling, but performance. Performance is one of the ways we pass on our history and pass on our
and
culture.
And it's the name for Heritage TNT, because I wanted, exactly, to teach them about the culture of the Carnival. So last year we did how the people came to the Caribbean. Different faces, one people, the Caribbean.
Definitely.
And this year, we're teaching how Carnival came to be. So,
well, my last question, a lot of people who will not be from the Caribbean watching the Carnival in Miami, sometimes they think that it's very sexualized and the women are basically wearing clothes that doesn't cover that much on the body, and they do not understand where it comes from, they do not understand the purpose of it. Mm-hmm. What would you like to say about that?
I think I would want to say to people that, I mean, it is sexualized. Sex is a part of our lives. I mean, it's how we procreate. But it's also when you keep in mind, again, this notion of emancipation. One of the reasons I think in Trinidad to date, I think women outnumber men something like 6-1, right? That there's a way in which women come out to express themselves. And it doesn't mean it has to only be sexually, but it's a freeing up away from these kinds of, you know, mores that say to be a woman in this sphere, you have to dress this way and speak this way and act this way. For these 2 days of the year, you find men dressing as women, women dressing as men, adults dressing as children. The idea of Carnival is the turning upside down of the world, and the powerful become the meek and the poor, and vice versa. So I think that that's an important, and again, it's interesting because that's represented in the costume, but it's also represented in the revelry, that there's a kind of abandon almost, and togetherness about, you know, it's some of those boundaries that for the other 363 days of the year that keep us in our confined communities, I think they're taken down just for that moment so that we can really begin to experience one another at a different level.